great battle. We'll see Chris Carawell and the Dukies against the Wake Forest Demon Deacons, the first of two ACC semifinals on ESPN just minutes away.
Charlotte Coliseum for one of the best days of the year in all of college basketball. The mission statement at Duke, domination. Behind the steely determination of its veteran core, this group of six does it the old-fashioned way, with teamwork. Wake Forest leaned on its hot hand and then turned to an old ace to knock out Carolina. Maryland's confidence seems to grow every time the Terps hit the floor, winning 10 of their last 11 ACC games. This group likes it fast and loose. NC State looking to steal its way to the finals with the return of some old horses and a new spark. Is the pack back? Welcome to Championship Week presented by 7-Up. We're at the ACC Wake Forest to face Duke in the first of two semifinal games. Here's the way we stack up the four teams that are left of the nine that started. The winners meet in the finals tomorrow. Good afternoon, everybody. Mike Patrick along with Dick Vitale. It's great to have you with us. Duke has dominated this league for a couple of years now. Their dominance extends to this. If they win this tournament with Cincinnati's loss, they will be number one in the country going into the NCAA tournament.
How amazing is that when you think about a program that lost four guys to the NBA? They lost the guy that transferred, yet they have a chance to do what hasn't been done in two decades. Yes, DePaul was number one, 80 and 81, entering the big dance. If Duke wins this tournament, they enter in as number one. And think about this. I think they are a lock, baby, for number one in the East in Winston-Salem, no matter what they do in a tournament.
Let's not get ahead of ourselves, though. Wake Forest might have something to say about this. For more on that, here's Brad Daugherty.
Thank you, Mike. Wake Forest comes into this ballgame after a great win yesterday over a good North Carolina basketball team. Wake Forest is playing the kind of basketball that could propel them into this Duke game with a lot of momentum. Robert O'Kelly is the key. He has to come out and give them big minutes like he did against North Carolina yesterday, hitting two big shots and making one very key assist in the closing moments of the basketball game. Mike.
All right, Brad, thanks very much. Let's take a look at the starting lineup for both ball clubs. Dick, what do you like in the backup in the backcourt for a matchup today?
Well, you know, Murray's now starting, but you look at Mr. O'Kelly. I agree when we talk about Mr. O'Kelly, he's going to have to come up big. And that doesn't only mean scoring points. Yesterday didn't score early in that game, but made three big plays late in the game. A key player for Wake Forest.
All right, how about up front? A little more even here, perhaps?
Oh, I love Sun Gaila. I think the guy has got great ability. He has to stay out of foul trouble. We know about the constants, Carawell and Battier, two warriors and two winners. But you got to watch Boozer on the inside, who can score big in the lane.
We are set to go from the Charlotte Coliseum. 24,000 on hand. Sengaila, the jump center, against Carlos Boozer. Mike Wood to toss it up. We are underway.
I think it's very important for Wake Forest to get a great start, to get some confidence that they can play with Duke.
Battier, who has been on fire, looks inside for Boozer. Loose ball knocked out of bounds by Wake. Wake plays very good defense.
Federetta's an outstanding defensive player in the post. Hey, great news for college basketball fans. Mr. Battier will be coming back for his senior year.
I think it's terrific.
I do too.
And he certainly could be the player of the year next year. Williams drives all the way to the hole.
No one rotated over. Jason Williams, that strong body, good use of the left hand.
Let's see where Wake goes with its initial offense. O'Kelly may have broken out of a shooting slump yesterday. Vitoretta, who is starting to show some shooting range, buries a baseline jump shot.
That's big for them if they can get some point production out of Vitoretta. Nice penetration by O'Kelly.
Nate James. Boozer missed the jam out of bounds to Duke.
I agree with your comment about Battier, potential player of the year next year. Probably be a battle between Battier and Chris Mim of Texas if he comes back.
I mean, what can't Battier do? There's not a hole anywhere.
He can play for me, Mike, anywhere he wants. I'd love to have him on my roster. He's just a great kid as well as a player.
Best three-point shooter in the ACC. He misses his first long-range drive. Howard pushes it.
Howard, a good-looking young player. Very good at transition.
Sungaila, he is tough.
Yeah, he can really score around the basket. He's got a lot of moves, can step out. His problem is with foul trouble.
Talk about the future. He's got first-team All-ACC written all over him for next season. Nate James stepped on the baseline.
Good little start defensively right here by Wake Forest. Sungaila now getting in deep. Here he is going against Mr. Boozer on the inside. Nice little pump fake, freezes the defender, puts it on the glass. Watch him on the inside now. See, he freezes. Look at that head fake. Oh, that head fake. Brad Daugherty used to use that all the time.
Wake Forest on top by a bucket. We played a minute and a half. Murray nearly lost it to Williams. Duke just so quick and so intense on defense.
Well, good defensive basketball team in that they pressure a great deal, but they're a better open court team than they are in defense.
Vitoretta, the tip by Murray.
Murray's a versatile kid. Since he has started at the point, they've been a better basketball team.
Wake has hit three of its first four shots and has a four-point lead.
You know, Dave Odom said, I respect Duke defensively, but their open court game in transition is really what separates them from both.
Carawell, nice pass to Boozer.
Boozer can use either hand, Mike. So effective inside. You know, when they lost those first two games to start the year, he was really just getting back in shape.
That's right.
A broken foot.
Tough matchup for O'Kelly here, being guarded by Carawell. Sungaila, nice pass to Vitoretta, and guess who reaches in? Battier with those great, quick hands. Crowd wanted a foul, they won't get it.
Well, you know, Battier was the minister of defense. We're going to watch Boozer on the inside now. There he is, using the left hand, spinning in the lane.
Sungaila, nice head fake. Another one, Boozer stays right with him. And here comes Williams.
Battier kept the ball alive.
Jason Williams, tough shot, spun out.
Boy, that was a tough shot. That was almost going to go down. Body strength got him in the lane.
Bad pass, saved by Sungaila. Nice play.
You talk about a game of urgency for Wake Forest. This is a must if they entertain any ideas of a big dance. It is a must.
Gonna run a walk.
I'm sure they'll say we're on the bubble. We beat this team. Everybody's got a case. We got 700 teams on the bubble.
Well, you and Digger each have 120 in the tournament already.
Digger has 8 number one seeds.
It's getting bigger all the time, isn't it?
I tell my man Chris Fala looks really sharp in that studio. We don't have to be an infomercial in this league, baby. This league sells itself.
O'Kelly. No basket, but a foul.
When I say this league sells itself, like, obviously anybody would tell you that the league is not what it was. It's not vintage ACC, but everything is relative as you look at Coach Day.
Dave Odom, until this season, had his team in the top half of the ACC for 7 straight years.
They started off so well. They were 8-1 to start the season, then lost a couple of heartbreakers at the buzzer, the Oregon, the Georgia, and they really never found themselves. They seem now to be playing the basketball that they played earlier.
One thing they have done, adjust their offense to go more to Sungaila instead of O'Kelly. And O'Kelly's been fine with that. He has changed his game. Had a half dozen assists yesterday.
Without a turnover.
Exactly. Battier. A great stroke.
I'll tell you, I love the way he shoots the basket. You almost feel it's going to go in every time.
Quickly back the other way. If O'Kelly can get the hot hand, this is a very dangerous team. He did late yesterday.
Are you surprised they're running up and down the floor? I'm a little surprised that they're not trying to control tempo Wake Forest.
You know, they played better in an up-tempo the last couple of weeks than they did in a half court. Howard from the baseline.
And there's Howard in transition. Excellent athlete, can really run the court well. But I think if you try to go up and down all day with Duke, it could be trouble.
All five Wake Forest players have scored so far. Battier really had to force that one up. Murray, Vitoretta.
Oh, hello. They're out hustling Duke right there. Michael Kay's got to be concerned. They're out hustling them, got up and down the floor.
Wake has hit five of its first eight shots.
They're saying, hey, we'll show you some transition as well.
Well, you know, coming in against Duke, you've got to score points because they are going to get theirs. They lead the nation in scoring. Again. Boozer, a great pass.
Out there, Boozer does a great job hanging around the basket all year long. He's been the beneficiary of some great looks to him around the basket.
Wake Forest showing no tension, no nerves.
I tell you, they're playing with a purpose, and they are focused.
O'Kelly.
Hello, that's Robert O'Kelly, the guy that was all ACC second team last year.
And the leading returning scorer in the league, who has struggled mightily with this offense all season.
Well, prior to yesterday, he was 12 for 50 in his previous game shooting the basketball.
Carawell has had such a solid season in every aspect of the game. Drains the jumper there. Duke back within three.
Well, right on cue, Mike. You called it. Carawell's been sensational. A player of the year in the conference.
Zingala hasn't touched it in a couple of trips. Murray, nice move to get by Williams. And then Battier is right there to knock it away from him. And a tie-up on the floor. They'll give it back on the possession arrow to Wake Forest.
I think there's some nervous people right now. If Dave Odom could spring the upset here, he gets a berth, it could eliminate some other at-large teams.
14:07 to go, first half. Wake Forest on fire early. They're up by three.
Teams around the country, South Carolina, St. Louis, trying to do what Wake Forest and NC State are doing in the ACC, atone for a regular season. But against the Gamecocks, Auburn has awakened. Doc Robinson knocks down the triple. Next possession, Holman, same thing. And the Tigers have finally gained the lead against the Gamecocks, 31-28 down in Atlanta. Conference USA, the Billikens in the second half continue to lead DePaul. Keep an eye on that game. Mike, Dick.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. We've got a three-point Wake Forest lead here. The Deacons have come out strong. Dick, their problem all year has simply been putting the ball in the basket. It hasn't been a problem for them today. They have shot very well. They've come out with a balanced start, and this is exactly what Dave Odom must have hoped for.
Well, a scoring off the turnover, they're really getting down the court quickly. Hey, I agree with Chris Follett about that St. Louis game. That would be a shock. St. Louis winning that tournament would steal another berth away from someone that might have thought they had it as an at-large.
Sungaila. Good pressure by Christensen. The rebound at Dunleavy.
Remember, Dunleavy's coming back from mononucleosis, came back at his last start, and went 6-for-7, 4-for-4 from the trifecta.
Yeah, they're going to want to get it to everybody next fall before practice starts.
He can flat out shoot the ball if he squares his body.
Carawell against Hicks. That's a tough defensive matchup for Hicks. Sungaila with a rebound.
Hicks pushes the ball up the court quickly. They're doing a good job executing, moving the basketball away far as getting good balance.
It's a very deep team. Dave Odom can go very long down that bench.
Experienced as well. I think Dave would be the first to tell you he was disappointed in their record this year.
Hicks with a tough shot, a running three-pointer, and why that's so big, he had only made five of his last 32 three-point shots.
Well, I'm going to tell you, Mike, when Hicks and Vitoretta are starting to make perimeter shots, you got the making of a potential upset.
Oh! Carawell tries to reverse. Christensen with a rebound, and he's fouled by Shoemaker.
We're going to take a look at a nice screen up on top. Here comes Sungaila. There's the little kick out. And there's the screen. Freeze it right here. Freeze it right here. Now look at that screen. Great screen. Sungaila does a super job. Here comes Hicks, the little curl move to the lane, and he splashes it. I like the way your enthusiasm. I was listening to you on some calls yesterday. You got a terrific voice.
Well, thank you. This is fun. How can you not be?
You got a chance to make it in this business.
Thank you, Dick. I hope it happens soon.
Oh, nice ball movement.
Williams with a man. What a
a screen out. What a screen out by O'Kelly.
They should take that and put that in a coach's manual. That was the perfect way to screen out. How size doesn't matter. Stay between your man and a basket.
That was truly remarkable.
They're focused, Mike. They are really focused.
Get around. Our Shoemaker offensive foul.
Take a look at this block out right here. Right here. Freeze it. Freeze it. Look at this guy. See how he stays between them? He won't let him make the turn. Look at that block out. Look at that block out. And look, he's trying to grab his shirt. Take a look right there from another angle. Oh, what a block out. That's a clinic. See, everybody wants to go to the basket and use their great jumping ability, and they don't block out. It's a lost art.
He is 6'1". Technique can win a lot of battles.
I got a big kiss and a hug yesterday from his mom. She had to feel good yesterday with him breaking out of his slump.
I think everybody felt really happy for him. Nate James short on a jumper.
Duke doesn't have that special bouncy strut here today. They really don't. They don't have that actual pizzazz.
Dawson, number 42, is in the game. He matched a career high with 17 yesterday. O'Kelly, the bounce pass to Benaretti's fouled by Battier.
I'll tell you, Mike, unless Duke starts to step it up and get a little intense and a little emotional on the floor, they could be in for a troubling afternoon. There's O'Kelly, nice look, trying to make the good little pass inside. We don't really hear him trying to shoot that. He would have forced that shot.
Yep.
Let's go, Come on, fellas.
Vitoretta at the free throw line, where he is only a 50% free throw shooter. Makes the first, he'll get another. He had been in the low 40s, so he has gotten better as the season's gone along. There's Irvin Murray back in the ballgame, and O'Kelly will get a breather.
You know, Wake played in tough the first matchup before they broke it open, Duke, in the second half at Wake. Down at Duke, they were totally in command. Duke just blew them away.
Vitoretta misses the second one, but Wake Forest still maintains a 7-point lead over the Blue Devils.
Doing a great job stepping out, helping out one another, cutting off angles.
Dunleavy, he's got that great stroke from outside. Battier, that one is short. Christensen on the floor, fight for it, possession arrow. We'll give it back to Duke in the jump ball situation. Great first half for the Demon Deacons. 11:29 to go. They're up by 7. Robert O'Kelly has seen his numbers drop dramatically this season in an offensive swoon, but his head coach Dave Odom says he's hung in there.
The one thing that people do not understand, they couldn't possibly understand because they don't know him, is that he cares more about the team than he does himself. And because of that, we're okay and he's okay, because he knows our team is getting better and he's working hard to pull his load.
They're doing all the little things here. They're blocking out, they're talking on defense, they're communicating, they're moving the basketball, and those are all the elements you need to win, Mike.
Him get out here and put up a new one.
Hey, you know, Mike, real topic today in all the articles in the paper here, where I disagree with some of the scribes in his state saying the fact that North Carolina does not belong in the tournament. I mean, North Carolina has been a disappointment. They haven't played with a passion and the kind of enthusiasm you expect representing that great uniform. But the bottom line is there's no way they do not belong in the tournament. If you compare them with all the other at-large people that are going to go for a bid, they have beaten the likes of Miami out of the Big East. They beat Purdue out of the Big Ten. They have blown away UNLV.
Well, they always play that great schedule.
Great
Duke
schedule.
Does, North Carolina does. And if you take the committee at its word that you have to play that tough schedule in order to guarantee yourself after a decent season of getting in the NCAA, then certainly if you take them at their word, they've got to be in.
Tell Bill Guthridge and all the Tar Heel fans to relax, baby. I talked to the VBDI, Vital Ball Dome Index, said forget the RPI, they're in. And Brad Daugherty, you're going to be smiling tomorrow when your alma mater gets in.
No doubt about it, Dick. I think they have an excellent chance of getting in. Like you say, they have key wins over Purdue, Miami, Maryland. Also, they have a very good loss, if you're going by the RPI, to Duke, but this Duke basketball team. They played very close in Chapel Hill, played a pretty good game against them in Durham. So I think they're definitely in. They're going to have to bring it a little bit harder, though, than they did yesterday against Wake Forest. I think it'd be a good opportunity for him to step up, though, and show what that NC's all about on that chest.
I'll tell you, the one team that I'd be a little nervous right now would be Virginia, because what can happen for Virginia, even though I feel they're going to get in, I think there'd be a problem if, for example, Wake Forest were to beat Duke here now. That could create a dilemma for Virginia.
Certainly the inconsistency in the ACC is one thing that has hurt the national perception of the ACC this year. But certainly I have seen the Virginia Cavaliers on nights where it looks like they could play with anybody. And how can you not get in with a 19-11 record and a 9-7 conference record? How would that be possible?
Well, see, when you talk about the Atlantic, the ACC, no one's not gotten in with a winning record. As you look right here at this record here, 9-7 basically in the conference, better than 500 out of the ACC. In fact, the only team that didn't get in with a 500 record happened once, and that was Georgia Tech. in the middle 90s. So, again, they're going to have a strong case as well. But we have to wait. There's too many things happening, and that's why we're going to get Chris and Digger to share all those tidbits with us.
If you just tuned in, they are not already cutting down the nets. They're fixing it. They'll cut them down later. Right now, let's check in with Chris Fowler.
Well, let's play playground style. Yeah, blacktop, no nets in the rims. In the meantime, let's check out Conference USA, where St. Louis continues to play well against DePaul. Pound the offensive glass off the miss here. Chris Braun with the tip in, and St. Louis, they would not have gotten a large bid, trying for the automatic bid, continues to lead DePaul. Word is Eric Barkley is expected to play by the St. John's coaching staff when the Red Storm take on the Huskies tonight in the Big East final. Guys?
All right, thanks, Chris. It's 18-13 here, and the team's doing a little bonding with the one available basket that we have left.
I'll tell you, interesting matchup. You just had it up there, that promo with St. John's at Connecticut. What makes that really interesting, when you look at St. John's having beaten Connecticut twice, they had a little battle in a locker room yesterday, Barkley and Thornton. He came out late at halftime, and then there's some word that the NCAA is looking into Eric Barkley's SAT scores, and that could create a problem. He announced yesterday after the game, shocked his teammates. He said, I need a little leave. I'm not going to play. Bottom line is, I think he'll get a hug, and I think he'll be in the lineup tonight.
That's been a very difficult situation for the people up there, and it opens up a whole can of worms for the NCAA. How difficult is it to police all the stuff that goes on with kids and all the summer programs and the agents and the shoe companies and all that stuff? Either crack down on it or let it go, one or the other.
Mike, I have a problem when they start going back into their early youth and into their high school days, what has nothing to do with the recruitment process. When a kid gets a little help to go to a prep school to make himself a better person, like Chris Carawell did to go to a Cardinal Ritter high school, that wasn't utilized as an advantage to go to Duke. Now, I have a problem if a booster is helping to pay for a youngster to go to a prep school. But if a kid has someone in his community that wants to help him and has nothing to do with a college and where he goes, I see no problem with that.
Yeah, but a lot of that is going to have to be justified. Was, does that person help anybody else who is not a basketball player or a football player?
That's a good
point. Normally, they don't.
They don't.
They're helping athletes, and that's it. And that's
a good point.
It's a problem.
That's a good point. No question, that's a good point. Coach K, I'll tell you this, four straight regular season ACC championships. Think about this. They could be the first Duke team to go back-to-back winning the regular season and the tournament since Vic Bubis did back in 63-64.
Well, four decades ago, the ACC was seeing some royal blue. The Devils swept four regular season titles, went to three Final Fours, and won three ACCs. 31 years later, they're at it again. In the process, they had that remarkable 31 straight conference record winning streak. I mean, that you just don't do that.
I tell you, it's just amazing when you talk about the totals they have achieved. Look at Carroll with 64 career ACC wins, most in conference history. I mean, that's unbelievable when you look at his numbers and what he's achieved in his 4 years. Was a role player and now has become a star.
You know, if I'm Wake Forest, I'm upset about the delay.
Oh, yeah,
they were
hurts.
Hot. They were on a roll. They were playing as well as they could play. And now after, what, 4 or 5 minutes?
Right.
You know, they got to pick it up again. We'll see if it changes anyway.
Well, we should write down the score with 11:06 on the clock. Plus five. Let's see what happens.
Howard gives it up to Murray.
Murray to the baseline, dumps it to Vitoretta. Nice catch. Missed the shot. The tip won't go. Wake still fighting for it. The rebound goes to James.
Vitoretta did not go up strong. I think he was surprised by the pass.
I do too.
He got really shocked. Murray, a good-looking player. One of those kids not going to get a lot of stats.
Boozer. Battier for three. It's unusual. He's missed two of the three.
That was typical Duke inside-outside action.
Yesterday, the Blue Devils made a record 17 three-point shots. Today, they are one out of seven from long range. Howard walked.
Maybe in 17, they put on a shooting show against Clemson and Larry Scheid's club. Hey, I'll tell you one thing. His club kept getting better and better as the season progressed.
Once they got their bodies back, they had so many guys hurt. Clemson did not have its full roster available until the 4th of February.
And also, the kid Solomon kept getting better and better.
He can play. That's why he made first-team All-ACC. It surprised some people because Ed Cota didn't make it, but I thought Solomon deserved it.
Well, Cota did not have an All-ACC year. Dunleavy misses the little jumper.
Dawson, who had 17 yesterday, comes off the bench, drains that one.
I'll tell you, he's learned from his uncle really well, Jerry Stackhouse. He can shoot the ball, Dawson. He was getting free yesterday, coming off those screens against North Carolina. He said he was shocked that he was wide open.
The lead now up to seven. There's a foul away from the ball on Sun Gaila for holding Battier.
They're making shots, Mike. They're making shots, and they become very dangerous because that's been their dilemma, shooting the rock, baby.
Wake is shooting 57% in this ball game. This is a Wake Forest team that is sixth in the ACC, less than 43% a ball game. Like we said, when they shoot well, they're very dangerous. Carawell.
What a nice basketball offensive movement.
Howard has everyone beat. Great pass and a nice catch.
That's the second time they have beaten Duke in transition. Duke a little bit sluggish getting back. Defensive transition and effort not there.
That will be a major subject of the halftime speech, won't it?
Oh, you're going to believe it.
Dunleavy.
Flat-out shooter. He's a flat-out shooter, baby.
Wake Forest has eight fast break points in this game. You wouldn't think they would. Dawson!
What a nice backdoor cut. Great move by Dawson without the basketball to get free and then under control, puts it on a glass, a la John Wooden style, when he caught at UCR.
Boozer wheels away from the pressure. Sangaila with the ball to Howard. Tough pass for Howard to handle.
He's got Carawell.
Nice anticipation by Vitoretta. He knocked it away.
Vitoretta thought what I thought. He thought it was going to go to Mr. Carawell.
Wake Forest looks terrific in the opening 11 and a half minutes of this game. Sangaila working on Boozer. Nice move. Boozer with a block. Must have gotten him with a body because it was a good rejection.
That's a tough matchup right there for Boozer defensively. Boozer, they're taking it right at him now. Not a super strong player on the defensive end, and they're going at him right here. There's Sangaila. Sangaila taking it right to him on the inside. Good spin move in the lane.
You wouldn't think it at 6'9", 239 pounds. A big guy is very active and tough, but he's the best free throw shooter in the conference.
He's got great touch. Boozer's getting better and better defensively, but his strength is on the offensive end in the post.
And Boozer will get a breather. Christensen comes into the ball game.
I think if you had a plan, and those coaches got together last night, Dave Odom and company, this is exactly the kind of start they would have loved to have had.
Sangaila, until yesterday when he was held to 10, had scored better than 20 in his last five games and really come on. And Wake Forest has its biggest lead of the ball game right now at 8 points, 26-18.
Well, he's become so much more aggressive offensively. Scott on the floor, good scorer, very quick, active.
Duke is tough to press. They have so many guys who can handle the ball.
Yeah, they got a lot of ball handlers. When you talk about Carawell, Battier, they provide extra ball handlers on the floor. James as well.
Carawell cut off the baseline, shot it anyway, missed.
I got a feeling Wake Forest is going to hang around all day, baby.
Here's the steal, Nate James. Great play to Williams. And Williams takes it.
He needs the trailer. Took it right up to the goal. I love his strength, the way he attacks the basket. The same with Jason Gardner from out of Arizona.
The Duke fans getting into it now. Howard. Tough shot.
They are playing well. They're playing like a top 15 team in America. They're playing like a team that people were projecting early this year to be a special team.
Wake has hit 11 of 17 shots to start this game. And James held by Howard.
It's amazing what happens when you play with passion. It's amazing what happens when you play with enthusiasm.
It's also amazing when the ball goes in the basket. That makes up for a lot of stuff. These are a few that haven't made it into the Charlotte Coliseum. You got two?
A little bit of Boston Celtic offense. The Celtics and the Red Auerbach were famous for this. When the ball went in a basket, they got up the court quickly. Here it is. Watch the score. Now watch Duke lackadaisical getting back. Freeze it right here. Well, watch this. Look how he beats them all. These guys are playing here, and he's sprinting to the goal. That's a no-no. Defensive transition, not there. And there's the little layup by Mr. Howard.
You really don't expect Wake Forest to get the easy baskets against Duke. You would think it would be the other way around, but today they are doing it. And Wake Forest hitting 65% of its shots, and they have 8 fast break points in this game.
Well, they're beating Duke down the floor, and that's usually something that doesn't happen. Nice pass.
Christensen got it inside, and Dunleavy is blocked but fouled.
Well, Mike Krzyzewski's club, so well coached on the interior. Once they touch the ball, they know people are available, and they're always looking for the open man. We're going to see him on the inside. Look at Dunleavy now, trying to get to the inside. You don't want to foul this kid. He's got great touch.
Antoine Scott committed to personal. Dunleavy had missed 4 games with mononucleosis.
Mike, my national coach of the year, my selection was Mike Krzyzewski. I know some people will disagree with me, always say, well, Duke's got great players. But when I ask you, can you believe a team can lose 4 guys to the NBA, lose a kid to transfer, and possibly go into the tournament #1 in America?
Well, let me ask you this. Who was responsible for recruiting the players? It was Mike Krzyzewski.
And isn't recruiting part of the formula?
Absolutely.
When you talk about coaches, they say, well, he can recruit, can he coach? Recruiting is part of the formula.
Well, there's recruiting, practice coaching, and then bench coaching. And you would be hard-pressed to find anybody who's better at any of those aspects.
And that's motivation as well.
Absolutely. Okay. Loose ball out to Wake. Dick, you're right. Sometimes your success keeps you out of the picture for awards because of what you've been able to do in the past. But this is a remarkable coaching job.
Look at the comparison, an amazing job. Dean Smith, I felt for years, didn't get the awards that he deserved.
That's right. Sengaila loves to drive. Did not get that one. James, loose ball rebound. Williams.
James been quiet.
Battier hesitated, drained it anyway.
He got a good look at the goal. That was an NBA trifecta. Squared his body. Look at the intensity. Look at the emotion. He's a winner.
Here come the Blue Devils. Battier has 2 long-range bombs out of 5.
Had you any doubt they're going to come back?
O'Kelly to Shoemaker. He's fouled. Nice play by Robert O'Kelly.
He's starting to create plays for other people rather than just looking to score for himself. Came out of Memphis. And by the way, Memphis, Mr. Calipari will be joining that university and taking over that basketball program. Memphis has had some great high school players. Corey Bradford now at Illinois. Now look at Battier, you're going to see deep. I mean deep. Look at this, freeze it. Look at that. Look where he is. I mean, that's way beyond the 3, baby. That's NBA trifecta time.
Shane Battier came into this game leading the ACC in long-range shooting 47%.
Doug Guthridge had said to me one time, he said, he's the most feared three-point shooter I have in our scouting report, and people reply.
He's just a terrific all-around player. So is Carawell, both first-team all-conference. Battier, what a move around Sengaila.
When you can do that, let's shoot the 3. I ask you, what liabilities does he bring to the table?
10 points for Shane Battier. Sengaila answers at the other end.
Sengaila, I'll tell you one thing, he's not intimidated by anyone. That kid's a big-time inside player.
He has 6. With Sengaila and Vitoretti, you could go to war inside against anybody.
Hello, Davey. Hello, hello, the
Mr. Dunleavy. Maybe shoot for his dad in the future.
We're tied at 30. Duke picking up the intensity, but Wake Forest not backing down an inch.
Those three-point shots can change the complexion quickly.
Murray. Sangala, great hustle, couldn't save it.
Shane Battier now going to work on a baseline right here against a good tough guy, Sangala. He spins on the lane, gets the good body movement, squares his body, gets the conversion.
Well, you can see in that replay what most people usually miss, the inside play with the legs, the bump, you know, knocking a guy off balance.
He's a lot stronger than his body shows as well.
Dunleavy.
Look at the two diaper dandies. Look at the two diaper dandies. Williams to Dunleavy.
Dunleavy has 10 points and 7 minutes off the bench. Oh, and Vitoretta accidentally, I'm sure that was accidental.
Yeah.
But he caught Dunleavy flush in the chops with an elbow.
No question. It was definitely accidental. There's no way. But look at Dunleavy. He's tougher than what he looks. He gets right off the floor. And I mean, he took a shot, baby. Take a look right here. Wow.
Ouch. Because trust me, if Vitoretta wanted to put Dunleavy out of the ballgame, he could do it easily.
Oh, look at that body he brings to the table.
Duke on a 12-2 run. Williams. Kept alive by James.
I love the way Jason Williams attacks the basket.
Duke got the wake-up call, didn't they? Vitoretta, that's a tough defensive match for Dunleavy. He really didn't have much of a chance inside.
They're not going to back away, though, Mike. These kids from Wake Forest aren't backing away.
Tied at 32. Boy, this has been a great way to start the day here in Charlotte.
Well, Duke's so explosive shooting that three.
Carawell. Nate James, another tough rebound. Battier short. Dunleavy.
All these guys can pass the basketball. Chris
Carawell with a block.
What a great score. He came out of St. Louis, didn't believe that he could really make it at Duke. Didn't think he fit in socially. Told Mike Krzyzewski, I have my doubts coming here. Played on a pavement out of St. Louis. No nets in the rims. Came here and became a young man. Senior day, it was unbelievable, Mike. The passion and the emotion. I had tears in my eyes to see the love he had with his mom. Great senior year for Chris Carawell.
Well, he said growing up the way he did with gangs, drugs, drive-by shootings, going to a place like Duke, he says he wakes up every morning feeling blessed.
He said he came on campus with a 1990 broken-down car, looked at all those sports cars that were on campus. I'll tell you one thing, Mike. He will not be driving a 1990 broken-down one next year.
No, you and I will be driving one before he is. 3 minutes, 41 seconds to go, first half. Has Duke taken Wake's best shot?
Teams around the country in NCAA limbo continue to sweat as Cinderella St. Louis continues to lead DePaul in the Conference USA final. Justin Love feeding Chris Heinrich lays it in. The lead is 6 for the Billikens. In the final 2:45, they just started the second half, and Auburn has a one-point lead over Cinderella, South Carolina. Mike, Dick.
All right, thanks, Chris. We're in the Queen City of the South, Charlotte, North Carolina. Duke up by 2 now after surviving a tremendous early run by Wake Forest. Duke, in the last 3 minutes and 20 seconds, has 14 points. First 13, they were held to 20. And Wake sprinted out ahead.
Also, 7 offensive rebounds means they're getting a little bit more aggressive. That's some story out there with St. Louis and the ball. St. Louis taking advantage of Cincinnati going to the sideline. And with Cincinnati, when I say sideline, losing Kenyon Martin, obviously, a big blow. That makes things interesting for Michigan State, Temple, and Duke, teams like that.
Yes, it does.
Win it all.
Sangala, nice job of splitting the bump, double team, and he'll draw a foul.
Sangala does a great job in knowing how to get free on the inside. Gets good position in catching the ball. Now watch him right here. Now he's a good drop step. Catches the ball, spins inside. Hey, Brad, you look at Sangala and you see some of his post moves. You see so much improvement from earlier in the year.
No doubt about it. The big thing, Dick, is he's been able to stay in ball games. In 29 games this year, he had almost 100 fouls, so he had trouble staying in. But he's a very aggressive player, and he commits fouls aggressively. Very good with his back to the basket, faces up, shoots the ball. He's one of the best best post players in the ACC, without a doubt.
Of course, Brad, he fouled out five times this year. That was a lot better than this year. It's a lot better than last year.
Yeah, Mike, he's real aggressive, though. He really puts his hands on guys. He uses his body. And the officials have to get used to that. And this time of year, ACC tournament time, they're going to let him play.
We're tied at 34, Sengaila. 8 points, four boards so far.
I would try to attack him to get him some silly fouls to try and get him on that sideline. He's taking the challenge of playing Battier.
James Walk.
That was it. Well, James really struggling here. Had a big game against Clemson at 17 and played well. Former West Point cadet, Mr. Krzyzewski, played for the general down there at West Point.
James has missed his only three shots from the floor, and Duke, which normally drives people nuts in the turnover department, only has a plus two advantage against Wake.
I thought they came out a little passive to start the game. You know, you think about Wake, I think about Lauren Woods as well. And what a year he's had down in Arizona. He's been out the last couple of weeks with a back injury, and that's going to be really important to them that they get Lauren Woods back in a postseason.
He, of course, was the successor to Tim Duncan in the pivot for Wake Forest. Had a lot of emotional problems when he was at Wake. Vitoretta tried with the left hand, can't hit it.
He would have been a senior in this league. I really think a change was great for him, and it really helped him immensely because he put so much pressure on himself trying to beat Tim Duncan.
Now that Dave Odom and his coaching staff did an awful lot for that.
They helped him. Oh, they helped him big time.
O'Kelly on a run, dribble it off his own foot, then tried to save it, goes down hard. Off of O'Kelly out of bounds. Brad Doherty with us today. Brad, what do you have?
Mike, every time Wake Forest catches the basketball when they're in an offensive set, you look at Darius Sengaila's eyes. I mean, they light up. He is so aggressive around that basket. They've done a great job of going right to the front of the goal. Even Robert O'Kelly going to the basket. This Wake Forest team, when they score, they play hard enough, they'll beat you.
That's the whole key, isn't it? If they can just shoot a decent percentage, as good a defense as they play, and as well as they rebound. Bodies fly. So does the ball right through the hands of Josh Howard.
Early in this game, Duke has not shot the three as exceptionally well like they've done all year long. They got to get James involved a little bit offensively. There's Dave Odom.
Boy, Dave really upset. Thought there was a foul underneath.
He's got two sons in the coaching business as well. Dave had that great run with Tim Duncan. The ACC went back to back.
Carawell slashes into the lane. Short, Vitoretta with a rebound.
Vitoretta gives him that great size inside. Very strong, very physical, and an excellent post player defensively.
Sengaila blocked at the baseline. Battier, just tremendous defense, but Vitoretta with a rebound. And now Howard with a three.
Let it down to Vitoretta, keeping the ball alive. Aggressive play by Vitoretta creates the opportunity for Howard.
They are playing with such confidence. Dunleavy just had it slip out of his hand.
They're playing with a state of urgency. Their back is against the wall, literally, in terms of an NCAA berth. And they got wins over Temple and Wisconsin. Remember, this team could play.
Here's the question. If they knock off Duke and go to 18 and 13, are they in?
I would say, I would put them in. I would put them in. Two wins over North Carolina. A win here. You better believe it, baby. Created a three-point opportunity for his teammates. We're going to watch Vitoretta release and go to the basket. He does a great job going to the goal right here on the missed shot. Freeze it right here. Freeze it. See this guy right here? He's going to get up on the glass, and he's going to be looking to this area to kick it out for an open three. Now, there's Vitoretta. He makes it happen. Now, look at Mr. Howard. He's right there. Squares his body. Knocks it down.
Dave Odom loving every second of it. Earlier in the year when I had a chance to talk to him, he was very optimistic that this team would have a chance to get better, and that was about the time when Robert O'Kelly's offense just almost disappeared, and they have been trying to fine-tune this thing ever since.
Robert O'Kelly's a perfect example as you look at the field goal percentages right here. Duke struggling shooting. That psychologically, if you really not on target, mentally you're struggling, how it can affect your game, no matter how good you are physically.
Well, especially if you're the go-to guy, and all at once they've got to find somebody else. That's a tough transition. Sengaila, Dunleavy tried to flop to draw the foul, didn't get it. Sengaila forced it up. Bodies fly, travel.
Wow, I can't believe no call right there.
Carawell. Neither can bounce. Mike Krzyzewski.
Carawell just bounces up. There was contact right there.
If you're afraid to go into the paint, you better take a dog. Wake by three, 54 seconds to go first half.
The next game's going to be a good one, I believe, with Maryland, North Carolina State. They had two unbelievable battles this year in a regular season.
NC State thought they could have easily swept Maryland this year.
They were up five late in the game at Maryland, and a technical foul really created a nightmare for them.
Murray, nice fake to get three, and then excellent defense by Dunleavy, and he's fouled. Coming up at the half, the 7-Up Halftime Report, Christian Digger, more SEC surprises, and champion from Conference USA, and the latest on Eric Barkley. That's getting weirder by the moment.
I know one concern among many of the Duke fans talking to him yesterday is the fact that they don't want to see Connecticut as a number four seed in the East if they're number one, because, Mike, that would set up a Sweet 16, and to have to play Connecticut that early at Syracuse, that's asking a lot, baby. This guy knows a little bit about tournament play, about winning a tournament.
Yes, he does. Dunleavy, 12 points off the bench.
What a stroke he has. There's full court trap right now by Duke. Little diamond trap.
O'Kelly, Scott, offensive foul.
See, that's an example of the transition defensively, the secondary part of the break creating the opportunity. It looks like you got numbers. It looks like you got an opportunity to score. Look at Dunleavy now right there defensively. Gets the contact, and Duke goes up the other way.
Wake Forest by one. Duke will have a chance to play for the last shot of the half and grab the lead. Psychologically, that would be very tough for Wake, wouldn't it, as well as they have played
exactly
in this first half.
Yeah, to go in that locker room on a minus side after an effort like they've exerted.
And the 47th edition of the ACC Tournament Championship game from here in Charlotte will be at 1 o'clock tomorrow. The winner of this game against North Carolina State, Maryland, coming up at approximately 4 Eastern time. We'll have that one for you.
You know, you talk about the granddaddy of all the tournaments accurately. And I'll tell you this, I was sitting there when I didn't
this
work
wasn't.
Here, and Friday, it was incredible. It was incredible in terms of a number of people from other conferences that are here to try and emulate and study what Fred Barakat and his people do in the way they run this tournament. This tournament is so well run.
There are the brackets, Duke and Wake, Maryland and NC State. And Maryland, we were talking about this yesterday, Dick. They are 19th in the country. They're the second seed here in the conference. I've seen a lot of Maryland in the last month. If that's not a top 10 team, I haven't done a game with them.
Well, you know, they've won 10 of their last game, 11 games in the ACC. And now what's happened with that club, Baxter's become such a factor inside. Blake's developed at the point. You know about Dixon, he's explosive. And if Terrence Morris becomes Terrence Morris, I mean, think about this. He was preseason player of the year, and now he's third on that team.
Duke will play for the last shot. Jason Williams, the freshman point guard, has gotten better all year as well.
He's learned how to understand the role of a point guard.
Sangaila steps out. Williams, little jump step in the lane, lost it, fired it up. And that's it. Well, Wake Forest survives the Duke run. And the Deacons, after shooting 54% in the first half, also survive 12 from Dunleavy as Howard gets 9 for Wake. And the upstart Deacons have a one-point lead over Duke. That's the story from Charlotte. Back to the studio. Chris and Digger.
Mike, Dick, thank you. It hadn't happened very often, only 5 times this year. But when Duke trails at halftime, they only have a 2-3 record.
I think Duke's problem is they come out and they want to shoot a lot of threes. If they're not making them, they get in trouble. They shoot 4-for-12 at one point in this game. That's why Wake Forest has the confidence to come up and make their statement at halftime.
We've got plenty coming up on our 7-Up report. A couple of Cinderellas still in action, and those teams sitting on the fence are sweating. We'll update the South Carolina game and St. Louis Cinderella bid in Conference USA next.
ESPN's presentation of Championship Week is presented by 7-Up and your local 7-Up bottler. Make 7-Up yours. Championship Week, presented by 7-Up, is brought to you by the new 2000 Mercury Sable. Mercury, live life in your own lane.
In Atlanta, they're going to the wire. Mamadou Njai just made a big block for Auburn as they try to protect a one-point lead over South Carolina. Tigers have the basketball as we join them for bonus coverage here. We'll keep you posted on that. Now back to the ACC for the second half.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. And we certainly had a good first half with Wake at one point leading 28-20. Right now at the half, they're leading at 37-36. And as you mentioned, Dick, Wake Forest came out with tremendous intensity at the beginning, which Duke didn't match, but they got to it in a hurry.
Well, I thought what really helped Duke get back in the game was Dunleavy off the bench. He gave them point production, 12 points off the bench. They have to find a way to get Boozer involved a little bit offensively on the inside. And James, who was 0-for-3, has got to be a supporting factor. On the other side, if you're Dave Odom, they want to continue and play with the aggressive style they demonstrated. They moved the ball, and what amazed me is the way they beat Duke up the floor for some layups.
Josh Howard was big, too. He had 9 points off the bench, averages, or as a starter, averages 8.4 a game, but in the last 12, he's averaged almost 13 points a game. And here are the first half stats. We've said all along, if Wake shoots the ball well, they can beat anybody. They shot 54% in the first half and out-rebounded Duke by two. They committed 11 turnovers to the Blue Devils, 7, and the three-point field goals, you expect Duke to shoot better than that as a team. They're the best in the ACC. They hit only 4 of 12 to start with.
These 5 minutes will be big right here for Wake Forest. They got to come out and establish some momentum and show that it was no fluke that they're up here. And as Chris Fowler said, 5 times Duke's been behind. They're 2-3 when they're behind at halftime.
Irvin Murray, who has taken over one of the starting guard spots. Howard now the starter at small forward. And Howard forced to shoot, got his own rebound, and put it in.
Nice play by Howard. Nobody blocked him out. Gets the lane to the basket. He's having a big, big game.
The freshman from Winston-Salem has 11.
He's got his prancing and dancing, and he's feeling good.
Williams cut off at the baseline, keeps his dribble alive.
He was 2-for-8 in the first half and had 3 turnovers.
Boozer blocked from behind. Howard came out of nowhere to get a piece up.
Well, Howard did a great job with help defense coming from the wing. Carlos was a little slow shooting the basketball.
And because it didn't hit the rim, the shot clock is at 8. Up to Williams. That one's blocked. Again, Howard. And he's got the ball on the run. Oh, Kelly. Nice head fake.
He did the same thing late in the game yesterday against North Carolina. Took the ball to the basket. When you're struggling shooting the basketball, you drive, utilize that to get the layup.
You said the first 5 minutes were important. The first minute and a half, Wake has looked sensational. Battier, and he's fouled.
4-point play, baby. A 4-point play. That is shooting the basketball. If you're evaluating now and you're an NBA scout, you really run to your charts immediately and you make a notation that he can take the hit while making the shot. Take a look right here. Steps back off the screen, gets the contact on his body, and still has the balance to knock it down.
Josh Howard had blocked 2 shots in a row. His third didn't quite get there, and Battier with a chance for a 4-point play, and the best free throw shooter, one of the best in the ACC, can't convert. Murray nearly had it taken by Williams.
Duke has been unable to come up with some good defensive stops on succession.
Vitoretta. Was excellent ball movement all day by Wake.
Yeah, to make it that extra pass and sharp and crisp.
Tipped out, recovered by Carawell.
Well, Carawell has not had a player of the year kind of game. He's been very quiet here in the first half and now the start of the second half.
Duke with a chance to tie or take the lead on this possession. James, who was 0-for-3 from the floor in the first half. Battier, 3 more? No. Offensive rebound. James, Battier again? No. And here comes O'Kelly.
Good
nice
job.
Decision.
Yeah, good basketball IQ, bringing the ball back out. Lay under control.
Well, Wake certainly isn't intimidated.
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, they started out, they were 8-1. They lost those heartbreakers to Oregon at the buzzer, and also to Georgia, really knocked them down for a loop.
Vitoretta and Battier really battling inside. Sangaila into the lane. Tipped in by Vitoretta.
Just beating them on the inside. No one blocking out. They're out hustling this Duke basketball team.
And that's the one weakness that Duke has, is the power in the middle.
Well, Duke's not a great rebounding basketball team.
43-39, Wake Forest.
Nice inside combination with some Gallo and Vitoretta today.
Williams has been quiet, bangs home a three.
They got so many weapons. They can hurt you in so many different areas of the floor.
James almost got the steal. Trying to explain to Carl Hess how he tipped it off a Wake Forest player.
See, the one thing, you're Duke, you don't want them to be hanging around with you going down to the last 3-4 minutes. Now watch Wake right now. Aggressive on the basket. On the boards, and Sangaila with the miss and Vitoretta with the tip.
Battier nearly had another steal.
Christensen on the floor, space eater. Dave Odom, former assistant to Terry Holland at Virginia for years. Saw Terry yesterday, fine athletic director now down in Virginia.
Let's see him a couple of times in the last 2 weeks. What a nice guy. Chance to work with him for a couple of years when he was in television. O'Kelly, that was tipped by Christensen. Nice defense, and Dunleavy with a rebound.
You know, Christensen giving him some positive minutes recently.
Williams, and that's a blocky foul.
Jason Williams out of New Jersey. St. Joseph's out of Metuchen, New Jersey. He's become a fixture at that point guard. So look at the professor. Looks like a professor right there, Dave Odom. Looks like a math teacher. He's got that math. Look at him. It's a mathematical whiz.
The only math he's concerned about right now is a 1-point lead over Wake Forest. Williams for three in the lead. And it touched the shot clock. So it's out of bounds to Wake.
Krzyzewski now a granddad. He's got a little grandson named Joey. His grandson will be celebrating soon at the new restaurant they're opening up. His son-in-law down there, the season ticket in Durham.
Good name.
Sports memorabilia all over the place, they said.
Sangaila to Vitoretta from 17. Williams, what a pass to Dunleavy. He can't do anything with it.
You just feel that Carawell's going to break loose for some big plays.
Baseline, tough shot. You just felt that, huh?
I just felt it's a matter of time. He's one of those PT peers. When a team is usually struggling, he comes up with the big play.
Duke has regained the lead.
He's been making those kind of plays all year long.
Sangaila against Christensen. Double team, Vitoretta. Williams.
Oh, what a way
stop in the lane. Did he walk?
Might have got away with one. Might have got away with him. It's close.
If he did, it was pretty anyway.
It was pretty. It was pretty. Good T.O., baby, right there. The Dukies now starting to move.
Williams, 9 points and 6 assists, and Dave Odom wants a timeout to talk about it with 14:59 to go in this game.
I don't know. Tough call to make right here. Does he get away with one here? I don't know, a little jump stop. What do you think? What do you think?
I thought it was legal.
All right, if you say it's legal, I'm going to buy it. You got two eyes, I got one eye. Nice move. You get the edge. Now, look, I didn't listen to you about the stock market. I mean, he gave me a stock, and I didn't listen. I heard about it. Okay, so I didn't listen. So I'm a poor guy, and you're a rich guy.
We've known each other for a long time. When did you listen?
I listened when you told me about a stock, our owner, our boss, Disney, baby.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did. 14:59 to go in this one, the first semifinal of the day from the Charlotte Coliseum. Mike Patrick, Dick Vitale, our entire ESPN crew. Glad you could join us. It's been a beauty so far.
I can't wait for tomorrow's Selection Sunday. How special that is. I'll be working with Chris and Quinn Buckner and Digger, and it'll be fun. We see those teams because it is chaos right now, Mike. It is absolutely wacky trying to determine who's going to be seeded and who's going to get in as an at-large.
Wake Forest would like to make it more of a puzzle with an upset here.
They would.
Hicks into the lane, short on the jumper.
They need a stop right here. Wake Forest has got to come up with a defensive stop. Duke's starting to get a little rhythm to their offense.
Williams. Sengaila with a rebound. Hicks wants to run. O'Kelly loves to get in the lane. Missed it again, and Wake has gone stone cold.
Last year, that was automatic for Robert O'Kelly. He would knock that baby down. Mr. Cobb, cool, Mr. Odom.
Duke has scored 10 of the last 12. O'Kelly only 2 out of 6. Battier with a miss.
He's struggling shooting the basketball.
And Fittoretta got it to Howard, and Howard turned his head to look up court and lost it. Maryland will take the court after this one. The Terrapins will face NC State.
A frantic SEC semifinal game. Gamecocks hit a shot before the buzzer to force overtime, but in OT, big Mamadou Njai is taking control for the Tigers. Gets the little baby hook to go. He's been making blocks on the defensive end. And here he is one more time in overtime. Auburn tries to protect the lead. It's a one-point lead. We'll keep you posted. Mike, Dick.
All right, thanks, Chris. It's a three-point game here with Duke over Wake Forest. Let's check in with Brad Daugherty. Brad.
Thank you, Mike. Rafael Vitoretta has been doing a great job on the backboard as well as scoring points. But it's overall aggression is what's been good for this Wake Forest team. He's brought a real attitude to this basketball game. You see him in the first half going straight to the basket, being very aggressive. 7 big points before the half. If he can continue his play in the second half, he gives Wake Forest an excellent chance.
And that's a guy, Brad, who has only scored in double figures twice this year, both of them 10 points. They don't look to him for scoring, but he's extending his range a little bit.
Yeah, they like him to screen, to play on the defensive end, and to rebound. I tell you, Duke's got to feel good about one thing. They're up by 3, shooting 37%, and Battier is 3-for-10, shooting the trifecta.
And they've only hit 6 of 20 three-pointers after making a record 17 yesterday. Carawell with a miss on the triple. Hicks over Battier. That's a tough shot. And great defense again by Shane Battier.
Battier's one of those defensive players that helps out, plays his man. He's so versatile defensively, can play a number of people on the floor. He can play even a guard if he has to.
He could legally change his name to Great Defense by Shane Battier, and nobody has a problem. Carawell throws up a prayer.
Yeah, he was out of control right there, Carawell.
Wake has gone scoreless for 4 minutes, the kind of droughts that have plagued them all year. Howard, and that's how you'll have scoring drought.
Oh,
bad shots.
Yeah, shot selection is so important to win basketball games, especially when you're playing a team and a quality of Duke.
Mike Krzyzewski calls out the play he wants here. This is Christensen.
Trying to get that good spacing, good movement, good screen.
Well, Carawell is wide open at the baseline, and it doesn't matter because Dunleavy drains a 3.
I'll tell you who set that up. The big guy, Christensen, utilized his body. Christensen got in there, made that screen, and Dunleavy took advantage of it.
Dunleavy has 15 points. Vitoretta double team, almost lost it. Body's flying again. Howard baseline. Battier.
What a pass by Dunleavy. I tell you, Mike, he's going to be a special player. Take a look at the screen up on top here. We're going to see Dunleavy come off the screen. Now watch it right here. Freeze it right here. See, now watch him lose the screen, pop in here, reverse the ball, and there is Dunleavy. Using the fixer, might have been a moving screen. Might have been a moving screen. What a great release he has. Great follow through.
Well, he learned from Bob Knight, did Mike Krzyzewski, and moving screens in that offense are nothing new, are they?
Oh, I tell you, we used to have a Freddie Gadelli was producing the games. You were doing a Sloan screen 45. Remember Sloan screen? Jerry Sloan's son. Look at the release now. Look at the follow through. See that hand waving goodbye, the rotation. I really believe that Dunleavy will not be a good college player, but it's going to be a special college player.
12-15 to go in this game. Duke has extended its lead to 7 points. And Carawell, who is in the top 10 in the ACC in virtually everything, including free throw shooting, misses that one. Duke on an 8-0 run.
Carawell seems to be a step off his game here this afternoon.
Sengaila loves that little fadeaway.
Well, go to Sengaila, and they're not going to go away. If you go to him, he'll convert.
10 points, 8 boards for Darius Sengaila, who averages 14 points a game, but has had a stretch coming into this tournament of 20 or more in 5 straight. Boozer. Roll right off the rim.
Yeah, he's been quiet. Boozer on the inside.
Murray, what a pass!
Nice look by Murray, and they beat him down the floor again. Something I have not seen all year. Duke beaten as many times as they've been beaten today in transition.
Shoemaker, for a big guy, can really run the court.
Well, he was a football player at one time.
50 to 47, Wake back within 3. The Deacon supporters on their feet here in Charlotte. Boy, this has been a good game.
They're really playing them tough. They really are.
Carawell cut off at the baseline, somehow got it to Boozer. Williams, Dunleavy. Boozer lost it on the way up, and they bailed him out that time with a foul.
So unselfish, giving up the ball, always trying to make the extra pass, and that's how you win basketball games, and something that Mike Krzyzewski believes in. You play as a team, share the basketball, and that was a perfect example, always making that extra pass.
Foul was on Sengaila, his second. Any more Alaskan All-Americans out there? He's the second in the pipeline.
Well, Trajan Langdon certainly was a great player for them. I mean, I was just sitting here thinking about what could have been. Could you imagine this club lining up with Elton Brand, McGetty, and Avery and company? I mean, think about that. Scary, the thought. Maybe the greatest ever in the history of playing basketball, except I don't think they would beat the UCLA teams with Lou Alcindor, because how do you match up with him?
No, but they might have to institute a mercy rule if those guys had come back. Sengaila will sit down, and Vitoretta comes back in as Dave Odom and Mike Krzyzewski both trying to keep their players fresh.
And that's another part of Duke basketball, making free throws. I mean, take a look at Wake Forest. Take a look at them right here. Sengaila says, yeah, give us that hit, baby. But I'm hanging in here. I'm staying there. Here they are, pushing up the court. Oh, they don't want to go away.
Well, game effort by the Gamecocks, but Auburn prevails in overtime to head to the SEC championship game. And in the Pac-10, Arizona State, a team that's trying to muscle its way into the draw. This would be its 11th Pac-10 win. They lead the Cardinal. They've had 13 turnovers in the first half, guys.
Wow.
Chris, don't you have to be from the state of Oregon to beat Stanford this month?
I mean, it's unbelievable. Think about that. If Arizona State were to beat Stanford, Arizona State would get a bid. How do you give them not a bid from the fact they beat UCLA by 29? Beating Stanford, it'd be unreal.
Here's the game summary from Charlotte. The Deacon shooting starting to fall off, but they're still at 48%. The turnovers now double, and Dunleavy, 15 points today in this tournament so far. He's 10 out of 12 from the floor and 7 for 7 from the three-point range in 2 games. He's working on all-tournament performance.
Oh, yeah, he continues like that. Think about coming out of mononucleosis to performing like he's performing.
Boozer tried to save it. The ball hit the end line. Of course, we talked about, you know, what. There's Mike Dunleavy coming off that case of mono. How important this is for Wake Forest. This is their shot to get into the tournament. But how important it is for Duke. They would be number one again in the polls going into the NCAA tournament.
First time it's happened back-to-back since 1980-81 with the Paul White.
Irvin Murray with a runner.
He's played really well. Murray has really played well. He's been a stabilizer. He's been a distributor. He's a kid that shares the basketball.
He's had to learn how to play in the backcourt. He was a small forward in high school. Wake back within 3. James has been cold.
Where have you been?
No more.
Where have you been, Nate James? Oh, they needed that big one. What's keeping them alive here and has them with the lead is the three-point shot. Even though they're not shooting well, the numbers, they made 8 versus 2 for Wake Forest.
That was the first field goal for Nate James. Duke has hit 8 out of 23 threes. There's a tough shot that goes in, and it's Craig Dawson. He's been huge off the bench in this tournament.
Yeah, you know, Dawson, every time he's on the floor, he was big yesterday against North Carolina with 17.
Hurt a lot last year. Williams left wide open, missed his shot.
He was too wide open. He pulled back on the shot.
Championship game action continues tonight on ESPN at 6, the A-10 Conference Championship. The Bonnies against Temple. That's followed with the Big East Championship, number 22, UConn, number 20, St. John's. St. John's beat Miami last night by a point to make the championship game.
I'll tell you, Connecticut really getting hot at the right time. Jim Calhoun's club, that's a club, remember, that's beaten Duke, beaten Texas, beaten Arizona. Oh.
Williams switched from the left hand, missed it, nearly tipped in by Vigoretta. Battier for three, look out.
You can't let him square and get the great look. Once he squares, he gets into that rhythm.
And Dave Oldham knows it's time to roll up the sleeves. Battier has hit 16, including four threes.
I think he's not fighting Mike Krzyzewski. Why is he rolling up the sleeves? What's Dave rolling up the sleeves for? Look at him. Look, he's going to ruin that suit. Come on, Dave, you can't ruin that suit. But I'm paying him big bucks at Wake. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Those guys buy suits like you can't believe. Look at those suits. Look at those suits. I mean, look at those guys. Are they a little serious?
Bozier picked up his third foul, and that's a big shot by O'Kelly.
O'Kelly's the kind of guy that can go on one of those unbelievable spurts.
Late in yesterday's game, in the quarterfinals, he found his shooting range. Williams, as they double-teamed the guy he didn't pass it to, got his own rebound.
Now, how does the little guy get in here and grab that rebound with all those trees inside? A sheer hustle. And it's lock up, locking out.
9 points and eight assists. Sengaila, turnaround jumper, missed it. Good block out by Boozer in the rebound.
We got to get Boozer some touches inside. He should be fresh, has not had many touches on the interior.
Any tank, any gas left in the tank for Wake Forest? Oh, what a rainbow, Nate James!
That'll hurt a little bit. That'll take some air out of you, and that'll take some gas out of that tank, and that's why Davey O called for a T.O., baby! Oh, Fowler and Phelps, the Dukies want number one in the East!
That one took a long time to come down.
But when it came down, it was NBA, nothing but nylon.
Dave Odom trying to keep the troops pumped up. They have played, for the most part of this game, just about as well as they can play, and they still find themselves down 10 to Duke as the Blue Devils starting to find the range from three-point land. They are now 10 of 25. That's 40%.
I'll tell you, that three-point shot is so vital. And look at Williams right now. He comes right down the lane with the offensive rebound, the little guy. He converts, and then Mr. James says, it's time for me to get in the action. Former McDonald's All-American at the McDonald's game in 2001 will be on the Duke campus.
Duke has hit their last 4 three-point shots.
They just got another commitment from another player from New York City, Andre Sweet, from out of Rice High School. They say he's a Carawell kind of player, and he'll be coming in along with Chris Duhon, who is legitimate and is absolutely a super talent.
That's good news for the rest of the ACC, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, I'm sure they're all excited.
Yeah. They'll be sending congratulatory telegrams to Mike.
I'm sure they're excited to hear that he's coming back.
Oh, Kelly.
Great movement without the basketball. Again, breaking Duke down defensively. I tell you, Dave Odom's not letting these kids quit. He is working so hard on that sideline. He is so into it. The man has got great mental toughness.
63-55. Boozer wants the ball inside, and it's an offensive foul on Boozer. That's four on the freshman center.
Vitoretta has really done a great job defensively on Boozer. He has limited his touches on the inside.
We've got a timeout. Dave Odom's club finds itself down by eight. He's not about to give it up yet. 7:46 to go.
Look at that smile. Look at that smile. The Pepsodent smile.
St. John's team turmoil is back on the same page for now. University officials confirming that star point guard Eric Barkley will be in the lineup when the Red Storm battle Connecticut for the Big East Championship tonight. They will try to beat Connecticut for the third time this season. They will have Barkley in the lineup. Should be interesting tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern, guys.
Chris, they could make a soap opera out of this, couldn't they?
I'm really happy that he's coming back playing, though, because if you're Connecticut, you want to beat them with their full lineup there, and I'm sure, you know, having beaten them twice this year, I mean, it's asking a lot to beat Connecticut three times in the same year.
Tremendous contrast in this game with three-point shooting. I mean, Duke lives and dies by the three. They hit a record 17 yesterday. They have 10 out of 25 today. Wake, 2 out of 4.
Take a look at there. That's 8-4. That's 24 points coming off the three-point line on the plus side.
Murray. Good pass to Howard for three. That's their fifth three-pointer. They've made three of them.
Okay, that's a big three right there. You're coming out of a timeout. You're struggling. You're eight down. And I really created, that was created during a timeout, that opportunity.
Howard with 14 points. He's hit two-thirds of his shots. And Wake is back within five. Make it seven as Battier hits again.
And as Battier again showed his multi-dimensional talent going inside.
Shane Battier with 18 on the afternoon. Sangaila wants it inside. Missed. Kept alive. Vinareno with a follow. Josh Howard was the guy who kept it alive.
Yeah, Josh Howard, a good-looking young player. He's a freshman. Doesn't get a lot of notoriety. He didn't come in with a big-time reputation. But he is going to be one heck of an ACC player.
Wake Forest serving notice. It's not going to go away. Dunleavy, good pass to set up Jason Williams for three.
Hello, they got so many weapons, so many lethal weapons.
Howard, boy, can he get down court and they find him.
Well, you know, that's a poor job again, defensively rotating back. Williams makes the three, and then I think he's dreaming a little bit about the three, and he doesn't hurry back on a defensive end.
The lead is six. Battier over Vitoretta. Carawell.
Carawell with a big offensive rebound. They wanted contact. The Demon Deacon fans wanted contact.
Well, Dave Odom was having a fit. He and Ernie Nestor just exploded off that bench.
Nestor, good assistant coach. These are the biggest 6 minutes for Wake Forest this year. Here it is.
Williams again. Long rebound comes to Murray. Three on three. Oh! Boy, Jason Williams went so far up to block the shot and then came back flat on his back.
Should have utilized the bounce pass right there. They got the deflection with the air pass.
Well, Jason Williams has some serious hops, doesn't he?
Oh, he's a very strong player. He's got good hops. He's got good quickness. Trying to get the spacing for that good opportunity. And I like to use dribble penetration. There it is.
Carawell over Murray. Carawell is having an off day offensively, but Duke keeping it alive again. O'Kelly. Howard. What a block, but a foul. Boy, Carawell just about drove him into the ground with that block.
Yeah, struggling offensively, but still hustling on a defensive end. Chris Carawell. Got a serious look today. You talk about urgency right now. What's happening across America trying to lock up those berths? And that's the dream that these kids play for. The dream starts on October 15th when they walk into that practice gym for the very first time. And they all can't wait for Selection Sunday, hoping and praying and pleading that they would be one of the 64.
Josh Howard has already doubled up his season's average. He had six yesterday, his best game of the year, 18 points.
Wake Forest won the ACC tournament in 95 and 96. Needless to say, they had the best player in America, Tim Duncan. In fact, Dave Odom was three times in the 90s coach of the year in the ACC.
Now, this is a three-point foul. The argument Mike Krzyzewski was making, he thought this was a pass, not a shot. Tomorrow on ESPN, starting at 5, the NCAA Women's Tournament Selection Special presented by State Farms. Robin Roberts, Vera Jones, Jay Billiston at 6:30. Chris Fowler, Dick Digger, Quinn, and Michelle Tafoya in 90 minutes of the Men's Selection Show to select the field for the national championship run. And Wake is back within three.
Not going away. These kids are determined today. They set the tempo early today. They were going to give Duke their best shot. They want to make something happen in terms of putting it on the table. A great win would be over Duke.
Howard has a career-high 19 points, and Nate James launches another one from the point.
All of a sudden, he got hot. He was blank in the first half. He's knocked out three of those here in the second half.
When Duke starts making threes, the other team's in trouble. Sangaila, double-team, forced it up, did not get it.
Now managing the clock. Now you get the winning time. And that has been the development of Jason Williams learning how to play, especially at the end of a game. See the shot clock there on the left. Winding it down, trying to utilize it. Bruiser.
couldn't get it. And that's going to be a foul on James over the back trying to get the offensive rebound.
Carlos Boozer really struggling offensively, trying to get some scoring on the inside. You're going to take a look. Nate James right on the wing. There he is, squaring his body. That's what McDonald's All-Americans do. And Mr. K says, I like that. That's a great shot, Nate. I like that. Great shot, baby.
Tremendous three-point shooting team. The lead is six. And it's a backcourt violation. Howard was trying to call a timeout before it got across that line, but he couldn't. And
Carroll looks like he might be a little under the weather. He doesn't have that spark.
Yes, he does.
He really doesn't. They haven't said anything to us, but I've watched him all year, and he's played with so much energy and enthusiasm, and I don't see that here today.
I'm going to wait for Josh Howard to lace it back up. He has lost a shoe. 71-65. Blue Devils on top as we approach the four-minute mark.
Watching the development of Williams at the point guard, brings back. They've had so many great point guards on duty.
A lot of contact, no whistle. Battier left alone. Did not get the roll. Shoemaker with a rebound.
See, right now, you talk about big possessions. Here's one of the biggest in the game thus far.
Boy, you're right. They need a bucket here. O'Kelly for three. Short.
A little bit long. Shot the ball from way behind that three. I thought you wanted to go a little bit inside. Maybe the Sun Island gets inside-outside action.
3:29 and counting. The lead is six.
They're going to be running some time off that clock. Spreading the court. Managing the clock. Something that Duke does exceptionally well. Spread the floor. As you said earlier, they've got so many handlers. Williams.
The ball just won't go down right now for the Blue Devils. Boozer gets the offensive rebound. He's fouled.
Isn't it amazing, though, you can have a subpar night shooting and still win because you do other things well?
Duke has 15 offensive rebounds in this ballgame. 3:11 to go in the first semifinal of the day from the ACC. Duke by six.
I'm always...
ESPN's presentation of Championship Week is presented by 7-Up and your local 7-Up bottler. Make 7-Up yours. And in part by Claritin.
Welcome back to Charlotte, North Carolina, the ACC semifinals. Duke leading Wake Forest by six, only 3:11 to go in this one for the right to go to the championship. And we'll find out very shortly whether it's Duke or the Deacons. The Maryland NC State standing by. That'll come your way at about 4 o'clock Eastern time. Well, and here's the tournament storyline from Charlotte. We've already had some records fall. Duke was 17 threes yesterday. Maryland, a team-high 25 assists. And Justin Gainey, a single-game-high 9 steals. This one at the bottom caught both of us off guard.
Yeah, really.
Maryland's in the semifinals for the 6 straight years, but Gary Williams, with all of his success, has not coached for the championship game in this tournament.
And also, Gary would like to add on his resume, going a little further than the Sweet 16 in the NCAA tournament. You know, last time Duke went back-to-back was 63 and 64. Question is, could it happen again this year? The answer, yes. But also, think about this. The last time a team went back-to-back, regular season championship, tournament championship, 2 consecutive years, was 73 and 74. David the Skywalker Thompson at NC State.
The lead is 6. Duke working some time off the clock with 2:59.
Made the shot clock. They're going to try to take some time off the clock. Got that 6-point lead. Right now, time is something they want to see disappear.
Nate James, another three.
All of a sudden, he has found his rhythm. And they go right to the hot hand. Williams with a good decision.
When they slow it down like that, Dick, they get such tremendous spacing. Somebody's going to be open for that three.
Jason Gila just can't make it fall. Murray will try a three. Rims out. Howard kept it alive. Sengaila gets a hand on it, and Nate James will be called for a foul reaching in.
Well, you know, Dave Odom did a phenomenal job. He and Ernie Nestor and his coaching staff preparing for this game. They had their kids ready to play. They came out, did a super job. Coach Turner, Coach Hake, really were absolutely ready to play.
Sengaila on the inbound, collected himself and put it home.
Going to have a big year next year.
Yes, he will.
They got some nice players returning.
74-67. Duke by 7. 2:14 to go. Here's the problem for Wake. Duke does this as well as anybody.
Tough to match up, but I don't think you can just sit back right there, Mike. I mean, you're down 7, and the clock is winding down.
You can do it for one possession, I think, and that's it.
Well, I don't know. I would come out and play aggressively.
Williams, he's bumped before the shot.
He is so explosive. Nice change of direction. Got a beautiful mom and dad, good upbringing, good family. Max Krzyzewski really proud of his assistants, Tommy Amaker and Quinn Snyder, both hoping and playing for a tournament invitation tomorrow.
Non-shooting foul. Wake has committed 6 as a team. More importantly, it's a fresh 35 on the shot clock. Now they're going to have to come out after. And they're such great free throw shooters, it just makes it all the worse. Boozer fouled on the way in.
As soon as you double up, they're going to find the open man from the post, using the post entry, trying to get the ball right into the high post area. Hey, before this goes any further, I know you are going to send, along with myself, our best wishes to our buddy Al McGuire.
Absolutely.
Oh, I loved Al. Al was my idol. When I was coaching at Detroit, I began to shake when I saw him on the other sideline. He's such a special guy, and now he's battling that blood disorder. And Al, we love you, and we will miss you in basketball. You're beautiful, beautiful people.
Had the pleasure of working a radio show with Billy Packer and Al for years and years, and just a sweet man, and we wish you all the best, Al. I hope you get healthy real soon.
Wow, you a Packer, McGuire, and Vitale?
All we needed was you on that show.
There'd be no AT for you.
No. 76-67. Wake needs points in a hurry. And James with a steal. He's clobbered by Howard. That is an intentional foul, and they'll call it.
Yeah, just go to the foul line, though. It was intentional. The officials are right on top of it. Just go to the line, make the 2, take the ball out of bounds. Dave Odom's club looks like NIT. 7-9 in the conference. Here comes the contact. Oh, no doubt about it.
Boy, and Howard is still woofing. Look at this. Howard is still yelling at a couple of the Duke players, and Irvin Murray is dragging him back toward the Wake Forest bench. I mean, you can't commit that kind of foul and then you be the one that's upset.
Exactly, and not expect people to be, I mean, you could hurt somebody there. So now you're playing great basketball, just play the game. Howard's had a solid afternoon. Great job by Murray. I thought Murray really showed good control.
Nate James is going to go to the free throw line. He was held scoreless for the first 29 minutes, but he's hit 4 threes since then. And he also has 8 rebounds and 3 steals in this ballgame. So he came up big at crunch time.
Came in so highly rated and had so many injuries. Came in with all kinds of accolades. Was a McDonald's All-American out of Maryland. Many people thought he should have went to Maryland, that he would have got playing time, but he really stayed and survived and hung around and got himself into the lineup, and he's become such a solid contributor to Duke.
Now Dave Odom is going to get Howard out of the Wake lineup, and James the free throw line. Guys very quietly talking to each other. Nate James turns around and looks at Howard after he makes that free throw. And you can understand Nate James. He wasn't really happy about getting blasted like that.
He's got a strong body. Howard played well today, but you don't want to spoil your performance by getting out of control.
Now only 1:20 to go in the game, and Duke with an 11-point lead. It looks like they have salted this one away. Carawell, bodies fly again.
I'm just absolutely amazed when I look at Duke's numbers.
Offensive foul on Carawell. Mike Krzyzewski really upset with that call.
I can't believe that call. Can you?
Didn't look like he had an angle.
Carawell said, wait a minute, I'm player of the year. I'm supposed to get this call.
No.
Oh, no. Never was there.
Plus, he reached in. Oh, you can see why Mike was upset.
The scoreboard makes him calm down just a little bit.
But Wake Forest still with a chance. 107. They're going to need some threes in here. O'Kelly into Vitoretta. Sangaila keeps it alive, but that one won't count. He was fouled on the ground.
Just a little thing that happened right there in that possession related to what you just said. They need some threes. So you know what Duke does? They come out and extend defensively.
That's right.
Get right in your face and make you bring the ball inside for a two. Now, people don't look at little things like that, but those are the little things that separate winners and losers.
Well, Mike Krzyzewski was not the six-time National Coach of the Year just because he's a snappy dresser.
Or because he went to West Point.
That's right.
And there's a look at his staff, Mr. Henderson, Mr. Dawkins.
Now, Howard's back in. This might be interesting.
I think it was great by Dave Odom taking him out for a moment. Grab him down, speak to him.
James with the ball.
What makes Duke's team so special is, as you said earlier, they can all handle a basketball. I look at Mike Krzyzewski, and I think of the fact that here's a guy with all the winning he's done. He just gets his kids to play on a regular basis. But the bottom line is, it's amazing this year when you think about all the people that they lost and to be in this position. There's his wife, Mickey, and his daughter. She's a vital part of the Krzyzewski coaching legacy.
Jason Williams goes to the line with 14 points, 11 assists today. Can you imagine a freshman coming in as a point guard, a guy who played shooting guard in high school, who has to learn the offense, mix in with all the other young players, two guys like Carawell and Battier, who were not stars last year. They were supporting players, role players, and making the whole thing work. That's just a tremendous adjustment for him.
Unbelievable. And then to win and to have your team in possible number one in America. And that's what I was trying to tell my buddy the other day up at ESPN, Chris Fowler, because he wanted to know if I was going to kiss Krzyzewski's ring when I entered here. And I said, you're darn right, I'm going to kiss it. But I don't care if he folds his hands and puts it in his mouth.
Dunleavy's helped a lot, too. Sangaila battling. Sangaila is not about to give up, and you got to hand it to Wake Forest. As hard as they have played today, I think they showed a lot of people how good they can be when things are going well for them. All they've got to do is put it in the basket every once in a while, and that's a good basketball team.
Oh, no question. That's been their problem all year long, shooting the basketball. They've been fighting and scrapping all afternoon here. They play like this, they can make some big, big noise in the NIT tournament.
Next year, they'll get Nicky Arenzi back. He was, just starting to get into shape. Missed all year 2 years ago. Then came back and had a tendon tear near his right ankle.
There's a Nicky.
And it's out for the rest of this season. I mean, with Sangaila coming back and Vitoretta. I mean, everybody's back.
Exactly. Well, the top club's got a lot of key players returning. You know, looking at Wake, is there an outside chance of them getting in the NCAA tournament? I don't think so, but I'm not making the selections. But I would think that Virginia and North Carolina would get the edge because of what they did during the regular season.
Sangaila hits them both. Here's a double team and the foul on Sangaila with 44.4 seconds to go. And really, this is all that Wake Forest can do is commit the foul, hope that Duke does not hit all the free throws, and then hit some threes at the other end and try to close the gap.
Dave Odom's a solid coach. He has great understanding of the game. I know he's proud of the effort of his kids here today. They played their hearts out, played a great game yesterday against North Carolina, had them prepared for the tournament. But they put themselves a little bit in a hole by being under 500 in the ACC. Losing those two games to Florida State. I think they lost to Florida State, my memory's saying.
I think you're right, too. And it's been the inconsistency of these clubs that has really hurt them this year. You see them one night, and they'll just be sensational. And the next night, they'll lose a game by 22 points. Williams misses the free throw. You know, you talk about youth in this league. There are so many young teams, and just about everybody, I think, is going to be exponentially better next year.
I think also important for the league is the statement that they make by the hire they make at Georgia Tech.
Dawson, a spin move, cuts it to nine.
Dawson has good offensive ability. I really believe they got to make a statement in going out and getting a major, major name for that job. That's a beautiful city, Atlanta, Mike. It's a great place to work. Bobby Clements done a phenomenal job in setting the tone there. I think David Brain, the athletic director, has some really strong options, but he just can't get just another guy who's an X and O guy. This league right now, what I think, we think back to Jimmy Valvano and Lefty Griselle, had such personalities. Dean Smith. And there's our buddy. Look at him, Bobby Clements.
In his playing days for Frank McGuire at South Carolina, Mark Price, the first big-time recruit he ever had. Mark Price led him to a championship. Rookie of the year 1 year after the other. Just sensational guards that Bobby Crimmins had over the course of time. Reached the Final Four at one point. And we, Dan Bonner and I were talking yesterday. One of the joys of a job like this is being able to meet guys like Bobby Crimmins and being around guys like Bobby Crimmins and being able to say, this is for you, Bobby.
This is for you, Bobby. We wore these today, baby. A tribute to Bobby Crimmins, one of the most beautiful guys you could ever want to meet. I mean, I'll tell you, he had a heart of gold as a coach. He loved his players, loved his kids.
And, Dick, he was really embarrassed by this whole thing.
Oh, no question.
He was really stunned by the outpouring of affection from everybody. And he shouldn't have been. He should have known how special he was.
I used to always tell Bobby when he first took that job, you're crazy. You have no chance to win there. All he did is 10 NCAA tournaments, go to the Final Four, win three ACC titles, an amazing achievement. I hope he gets back in coaching. Somebody will benefit. I would like to see him take a year off, relax, get the gas tank filled again, and go somewhere and be special, because the guy is a special, special person.
Well, you know what? You might have been right about Georgia Tech, except for Bobby Crimmins. I don't know that anybody else could have won there. You needed a Bobby Crimmins-type personality and his energy. 82-71, Duke up by 11. Wake down a desperate situation. O'Kelly, nice drive with 25-9 on the clock. That cuts it to nine. Now they need steals and a miracle in order to advance to the ACC Finals tomorrow. Championship game action continues tonight on ESPN starting at 6 with the Atlantic 10 Conference Championship, St. Bonaventure in 7th-ranked Temple, followed by the AT&T Big East Conference Championship, UConn and St. John's, both in the top 25. And we understand that Eric Barkley will indeed be in Mike Jarvis's lineup. And Mike Jarvis, a wonderful job he did at George Washington and then again at St. John's.
You know, it's really interesting. The last time they played, the two guards, Elamine and Mooring, did not make a shot against the St. John's guard combination of Barkley and Thornton. So you got to believe tonight Jim Calhoun's kids are going to come out and play with a lot of fire. But that's a very quick St. John's team, very athletic, very explosive, and they do play well on a defensive end. Temple and St. Bonaventure, interesting. St. Bonnie's trying to go to the NCAA tournament for the first time since 1978. And I'll tell you this, the win over Dayton helps them big time. But now they got an unbelievable test with Temple, because I think Temple is going to be a number one seed in the NCAA tournament. I think Temple, Michigan State, and you look at Duke, and then that other one is wide open.
Well, this is a classy move by Dave Odom. He's just going to back off, not commit the intentional foul. What else would you expect from a class guy like Dave Odom? He's going to let this one in naturally. And Wake really gave it everything they had today. They gave Duke everything they wanted and a little more.
And Mike Krzyzewski's telling them that the kids really came to play today. And I'm sure Dave's saying, hey, lots of luck when you guys go on to the big dance, represent the ACC in big time style.
So we're halfway home as Mike Krzyzewski guides his team into the championship final tomorrow afternoon here in Charlotte, North Carolina. Only one more piece to the puzzle remaining. Will it be second-seeded Maryland or number 6 North Carolina State? We'll find out at 4 o'clock Eastern this afternoon. Duke lives and dies on the three-pointer. They lived with it in the second half this afternoon. Terrific as usual. The final 82-73 from Charlotte. For Dick Vitale, this is Mike Patrick. Thanks for watching. Let's go to Chris and Digger.